In this topic, we're going to look at SQL databases, and in particular, kind of comparing and contrasting looking at SQL with using IaaS or infrastructure as a service and SQL with PaaS or platform as a service. So the cool thing about using SQL in Azure is that pretty much everything kind of looks and feels the same that it did before, for the most part. There's some things that are different. We'll show you some of that in the portal. But a lot of your familiar tools, you know, the way you connect to databases, a lot of that's very, very similar. But when you go from on-premises to up in the cloud, so now we move these workloads or can connect and communicate up to our IaaS instance or our PaaS instance. So what we want to do before we get kind of real specific is look at the big picture. So on the slide here, we have, this is kind of the large continuum. Now we're going to focus on the IaaS and PaaS part, which are these two here, right? But going from the left to the right, so first you have your physical server, right, which you may have already had on premises. And then some organizations will actually set up a private cloud so they could have virtual servers in their private instance as well. Okay, but most of us are probably using the public cloud, so we could do IaaS or PaaS. Now, if we do IaaS, so this is where you would fire up a brand new VM, and in that virtual machine that you built, then you would go ahead and install SQL. Now, of course, the cool thing about that is that you can install any flavor of SQL you want, any version you want, right? Because it's just another server that's being built up there. If you use PaaS, then you're using what they have up there in the cloud already for you. So it's kind of a two-part process, right? So you create a SQL server, and then once you do that, then you can add a database to it. And then as you add more databases, you can then manage these all from your Azure portal, which is very, very cool. And then the third option, we're not going to go into specifically here, but we might briefly mention, is that we have software as a service. So there are offerings out there that you can grab from the marketplace, right? Is there something you knew about from that? Or?
No, I just wanted to comment that when we're using IaaS SQL, so when you go to spin those up, you could go create or script out, as we talked about in other topics, you could actually put that in an ARM template or even something like a chef recipe and have your SQL installed the way that you want. But if you actually go up to the marketplace when you're in the portal and you see the virtual machines up there that have SQL pre-installed, so we have ones that are specific for transactional workloads or analytic type workloads. There's a bunch of different ones that are built up there in the marketplace. But keep in mind that those are built in a different way. So you can bring your own license if you're going to build your own VM. Or you can, if you use one of those from the marketplace, just be billed for that VM and the SQL cost is baked in. So that's an important point to remember if you're going to bring your own licenses. So if you already have an account with Microsoft and have the software licenses for SQL Server, you probably want to bring those along. You don't want to go provisioning ones in the marketplace and pay for SQL again. So something key there to think about.
Good to be cost effective there. So, all right. So in the next part here, we're looking at specifically kind of the topic at hand, and that is, you build an Azure VM and install SQL versus doing an Azure SQL database, which we configured in the portal. So let's look at these in comparison. So we talked about on the left-hand side, we build a VM with SQL. It's more management. Just like we said with kind of the continuum of doing IaaS to PaaS, PaaS can be faster, cheaper, better, but IaaS, you can have more control. You can do anything you want. But the flip side is you have to do more management and maintainability and controlling and patching and updating and all that sort of stuff. Also, let's look at some other points here. So you can, as we mentioned, you can run any SQL Server version you want in there. You have full on-premise compatibility, so you can connect back with your on-premises and vice versa. You can choose different VM sizes. And of course, if we do availability sets, we can get our SLA. We can also configure always on, SQL always on, which is an option. Actually, that's a built-in option, right, that does it automatically for you.
Yeah, it's important to point that out. So always on clustering is our failover clustering technology in SQL Server. Yep. And that's one of the few workloads that you can run an actual Windows cluster inside Azure.
Yeah.
Always on.
And I tell you, from what I've seen from a lot of customers, they hear about that and they're like, wow, we really want to do that. But then they go to try to build that on-premise and they don't, it's kind of confusing. It's a little bit tricky. But in Azure, it makes it much, much easier. It's just an option you select and it will build it for you automatically. Additionally, with the Azure VM, you can reuse your existing Active Directory on-premises infrastructure as well. Now, in comparison, on the Azure SQL database, you access a DB, a database, which you create up in Azure, and I'll show this in a second, and it is fully managed, high available, backups, patching, all that sort of stuff. You run the latest SQL version based on the Enterprise Edition, and there's even, we'll take a look at, we'll see there's a V12 that gives you all the latest, greatest things that you can get as, if you want. Incomplete on-premise compatibility, so there's no jobs, link servers, file streams, so that's something you need to think about in your design and architectural decisions.
So just to interject here a second, yep. Yeah, so at customer engagements, this is probably one of the biggest things to think about when you're thinking about moving to Azure PaaS SQL or Azure SQL Database. So it's a great option because it kind of eliminates or mitigates the need for so much backups and redundancy because we're going to go ahead and write, every time we write something to that primary database, it's going to get written three times inside that same data center in that same region. And then if you turn on geo-replication, it'll actually asynchronously get replicated to another location. So that kind of really helps you out from a DR standpoint, even the HA standpoint. But the thing to think about is, you know, things like file streams. That's something people always run into because users have implemented that over the years. And that's not complete. We can't have that feature in Azure. Now, typically what we do is a migration then and try to move those file streams out to something like blob storage and do a migration like that. A little bit of code involved, a little bit of work, but once you do it, you get a lot of benefit from the PaaS install.
Excellent. Very good points. Thanks. So some other final points here are on the slide. So looking at the different database sizes, you can get basic, premium, and of course, there's different criteria that are used to manage those. We get a nice little chart we'll show you. And then, of course, at the bottom is the great point here is that we get an SLA of 99.99%. Now, let's switch over to the portal just real quickly.
While you're switching over, yep. The one last thing I'll point out from a compatibility sense, right now we only support SQL logins if you're using Azure SQL Database. So you can't use Windows integrated authentication if you're using an Azure SQL Database. A lot of times that's baked into the application, so something to consider, and it's definitely for the security guys in your network. They probably want to know about that.
Okay, great. Now on the portal here, on the new Azure portal, I just want to show you, I created just a couple real quick samples, and not going to get into the how-to configuration, we can look at that later on. But so in the top right-hand corner here, I'd created a SQL server, and then in the middle, so you have a pane here that I pinned on here for SQL databases. So if you have a whole bunch of databases, it will show them all in here. You can see the list of all the databases. But the nice thing here in the portal, in the new portal, is I can just right-click on this one. That's actually the specific one. And when I go to settings here, I can look at all the different aspects of it. So I see all the properties. The pricing tier that we're in, that we selected, the collation, there's my database connection strings, we need to connect to that, my location, server admin, and then also if we have geolocation or geo-replication set up, how that's set. And also, something that's really cool that you can do is for the auditing, if I have, if I built a server and have multiple databases, you see here that I can inherit those audit settings from the server, so those settings will apply to all of them, or if I deselect that, then I can kind of break that inheritance, okay? All right, so from a lift and shift perspective, you know, here's kind of, again, the comparison on the left-hand side. If we have a SQL instance in Azure VM, we can migrate existing apps. It's just really kind of for a few SQL servers. But if you really need to scale, build out, and get the elasticity and the hyperscale that Azure provides, the Azure SQL Database is really a better solution where you can build new applications and go to 10 to hundreds of databases at once. And that concludes our topic in doing a comparison of SQL databases in Azure IaaS versus Azure PaaS.